Hi everyone, welcome to our online service for today, 22nd of November, which is also Christ the King Sunday. And as that name suggests, this is the Sunday right at the end of the church year, before we start Advent, when we pause to think about what the Kingdom of God is really all about. It's a day to affirm God's reign over injustice and to remind ourselves that the kingdom that we affirm and work towards is one where all should hunger and thirst after righteousness. Let's begin our time together now with a prayer. We have been called into the pastures of God, wherever we may be watching this morning, to those pastures where there is nurture, a place to rest, safety and kindness among all. So let's draw near now in the goodness of God to be with each other and to praise the shepherd who has gathered us here. Amen. Well, our first hymn is Great is the Lord, after which Angela will read to us from the Gospel according to Matthew.
Turn. This morning's reading is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. The sheep and the goats. When the Son of Man comes in glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" And then he will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did not do it for one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Angela, for that reading. Well, there's a lot of judging going on, isn't there, at this time of the year. Every Saturday night, we watch with bated breath and we wait for the announcement. The judges' scores are in. Craig Revel Horwood, 6. Shirley Ballas, 7. Motsi Mabuse, 8. Every week, the couples in Strictly Come Dancing work flat out on their routines all week, give it everything they've got, hit the dance floor with grace or passion or whatever the dance requires, and then they wait for judgment. Sometimes elation, sometimes relief, sometimes sadness, as every week one couple is judged to be the weakest and has to leave the show. And it's the same story with that other show on our screens at the moment, MasterChef. Every episode sees two people get through to the next round and two chefs judged to be not quite worthy. "I loved your Dauphinoise potatoes, but your duck breast really needs to be just that little bit more crispy." Judgment is a hot topic in our Bible reading this morning as we read about the Son of Man coming in glory at the end of time. All nations gathered before him, and he divides people from one another as a shepherd divides the sheep in his flock from the goats at the end of the day out in the pasture. The sheep go to his right hand, and the goats go to his left. the judge's score is in. The sheep go to the right and inherit God's kingdom. They are his children, his heirs, because of the way they serve the least of God's children, by feeding, clothing, welcoming, caring for them, visiting them in whatever prison life had thrown up around them. The goats go to the other side because they haven't ministered to the least of God's children in these ways. So preoccupied have they been with putting themselves and their own needs first. And the funny thing about this vision Matthew presents us with is that both the good guys on the Lord's right hand and the not so good guys on his left hand are equally surprised at the judgment they receive. The sheep are those who have gone about their lives treating those in need with compassion, without fanfare, and without needing to be told. The surprise shown by the goats is that of those who are complacent and whose complacency is shaken to the core. When did we ever see you in need, Lord? Why didn't you tell us it was you? The sheep have treated those in need with love and compassion without thinking about it. They just love and minister to those others in compassion and generosity, because that way of being, that way of thinking and acting, has become second nature to them. They are those who, somewhere along the line, have grasped in their hearts just how high and deep and broad and wonderful is the love that God has shown first to them. They are those who have come to believe that Christ's life, death and resurrection mark the beginning of God's restoration of the world, and that we are promised that we are a new creation within it. They are people who have begun the process by which the Holy Spirit gradually transforms them into the people God intended them to be. Christ's Spirit has come to dwell within them and shape them gradually into his likeness. And to become like Christ is to reflect more and more his love and his compassion to those around us. The sheep are the kind of people who bring hope and transformation to the least of God's children. The goats are equally puzzled at Jesus' comments, but for different reasons. They've got so used to looking after number one, so self-centred, so unthinking about the needs of others, that they have gradually moved more and more away from being the people God made them to be. And because the move away has been gradual and steady, they've stopped noticing their direction of travel. The further they go down this path, the more distant they become from God, the harder it is for them to be in relationship with him. God's love is always there, ready to reach them, but as all Strictly fans know, it takes two to tango, and you can't have a relationship with a person or with God if the love is only moving in one direction. God is love, and in his love, God creates us to reflect his image and be in relationship with him. When human beings give their heartfelt allegiance and worship to something that is not God, they gradually and progressively cease to reflect the image of God. Instead, little by little, they take on the nature of the thing they worship and reflect it outwards to the world around. So those who worship money increasingly define themselves in terms of it, and increasingly treat other people as creditors or debtors, partners or customers, rather than human beings. Those who worship sex define themselves in terms of it, and increasingly treat other people as actual or potential sexual objects. Those who worship control or power define themselves in terms of it, and begin to treat other people variously as collaborators, competitors, or pawns. These and many other forms of idolatry combine in many, many ways to damage the image of God in the people concerned and the people whose lives they touch. As these people progress down this road, refusing all whisperings of good news, all glimmers of the true light, all promptings to turn and go the other way, all signposts to the love of God. They eventually, by their own effective choice, become creatures who have ceased to bear the divine image at all. They pass beyond the point of relationship with God. They have, in effect, placed themselves beyond his love. They have become the goats. C.S. Lewis wrote that humanity is divided into those who humbly say to God, "Thy will be done," and those to whom God says in the end, "Okay, thy will be done." The sheep and the goats. Without judgment, there would be no compelling Saturday and Sunday nights viewing of Strictly Come Dancing. Somebody has to go from the competition in order for it to work well as good TV. And without judgment, God could not be a God of justice. In a world where horrors are still too frequently perpetrated, judgment, the declaration that this is good and to be upheld, and that that is evil and to be condemned, is the only alternative to chaos. There are two things, I think, to remember then about judgment. The first is that it's down to God, not us, thank goodness. To the human eye, shorn sheep and goats can very easily be mistaken for each other when they're out in the pasture. Wheat and weeds are sometimes indistinguishable. Left to ourselves, we very often fail to see that goats can sometimes masquerade as sheep, and sheep too easily assumed to be goats. So let's leave it to God. And then the other vital thing for us always to remember about God's judgment, I think, is this. Its hallmark is mercy and love. Our God is a God of love, whose dearest wish is that all humanity should rejoice and be in relationship with him when the new creation is complete. In John's Gospel, Jesus says, "And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day." It's the exact opposite, if you like, of shows like Strictly Come Dancing and MasterChef, where the judges start with lots of people and each week decide who will be discarded until they eventually end up with one winner. No, God's judgment works the other way round. God's judgment starts with just one man, a man on a cross, and seeks as its goal that all humanity, all creation, should be winners. God, in his infinite love and mercy, has done everything he can do to make us all winners. Whether we stay in the show is, in the last resort, down to us. So I guess the challenge to us on this Christ the King Sunday, this last Sunday of the church year, I guess it's this. As we look back, what have we done? How do we see the kingdom of God working out in Bures, in Assington, and in Little Cornard? I can think of various acts of care and kindness going on quietly around the place, and I'm sure that you can too. Little snapshots of the kingdom of God here and now. Christ the King, the loving shepherd, calls us to clothe the naked, visit the sick, feed the hungry, bring back the stray, bandage the wounded, make the weak strong. This is no more than a challenge to share what we have been given, to forgive others as we are forgiven ourselves, to show mercy to others as his mercy has been given to us, to love as we are loved. Well, now Dick is going to lead us in prayer, following which we listen to our second hymn, King of Kings, Majesty.
Heavenly Father, we start our prayers by praising you. We praise you for your creation and the way that all our needs are met through your love for us. We praise you for the recent hopeful developments in research for COVID inoculation. We praise you for the gift of your Son for us. He came to earth to experience what we go through, and in the end paid the price of our sin when he died for us on the cross. We praise you that his death has freed those who trust in him from fear of physical death, our passing being but the next step to sit next to him in heaven for eternity. We praise and thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to help and guide us. You know that we are too weak and feeble to manage on our own, and we need that extra bit of help. We praise you that you will judge us. Who could possibly want anyone else as their judge? Balanced, caring, loving, honest, all-knowing and fair. We are also grateful that you will judge all people, so that those who think they've got away with it on earth, or those whose crimes are too awful for human punishment, will be judged and punished at the end time. We ask you to help us to see you in everyone we meet, so that we can show them the love we feel for you. Help us to try to love the unlovely, the unloved, the unlovable. With your grace and the Holy Spirit, we can do that. Help us to seek opportunities to put ourselves second and the needs of others before our own. Help us to be generous with the blessings you have given us, be they time, money, cooking, or affection, because that is what you have told us to do, and because the world will be a better place if we do it. Help us to forgive those who have offended or upset us, so that we are at one with the world, for no one knows when those golden trumpets will sound the assembly for Judgment Day. We pray for those who are known to us who are unwell, either physically or mentally. Bring peace and healing to them. We pray for the NHS staff as the tempo of winter care increases and they are feeling more stretched. We pray for more success with the COVID inoculation research, and in particular for a cheap and easily stored vaccine for the poorer countries, so that poverty is not a barrier to a cure, and all your children will have access to it. We pray for refugees across the world as winter approaches, surely an example of the needy in which God sees himself. Let us each make a little donation this Christmas, sacrificing something for ourselves, so that we can give to someone with nothing. We pray for our church, that you will bless the clergy and the congregation of all three churches and keep them safe as Christmas approaches. We pray that the nation will be able to worship together in churches over Christmas to celebrate the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem all those years ago. We pray for peace, particularly in Ethiopia, Eritrea, Niger, Afghanistan and Yemen. And we pray for the return of your kingdom on earth, that it will come soon to end all the unhappiness and conflict across the world. We offer all these prayers to you, knowing that you are our loving Father and our Judge. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us now join together and say the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen.
So now we bring our service to a close with a prayer and with a blessing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we consider the parable of the sheep and the goats, let us be followers who seek to encourage unity and peace among all those who are made in your image. May we never be people who rush to judgment or fall into the trap of condemning or criticising harshly those who do not share our beliefs, political views, or cultural values. May we display your compassion, integrity, and wisdom when engaging with others, remembering your cautions to judge not or cast the first stone. Rather, may we be those who welcome the stranger, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, care for the sick, and visit the prisoner. This we all ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And so the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.